Change those tires on.
Green to shine. Remember, they fan out down there to protect that bottom.
Sunday drive.
All right, off, man. Pace cars off.
Be ready.
Right, bud, be ready. Gas that bitch up.
Ready, ready. Green flag.
Green, green. Welcome, everybody, to the Inside Pass. Randy Miller back with you. Another week of racing talk. And guess what? The gang is all here this week.
Woohoo.
It's amazing. I love it. Tom's back. Peter's here. Noah's here. Chris is pushing buttons. And all is right in the world. So.
And Randy's here.
Well, I guess I say I have to be here. I don't guess I have to be here. The only one that has to be here is Chris. But last week was a little bit of an adventure because we didn't think anybody was going to make it to the show.
I think we should do an entire show with Chris impersonating each of our voices one week. I think that would be...
You don't want to do that.
I actually kind of want to do that now just to see what happens. So lots of stuff to talk about coming out of the Martinsville week before we go to Richmond. We're staying in Virginia for another week, much like we did with Florida at the beginning of the year. We're going to stay in Virginia for another week. For the Richmond race this weekend, but we've got a lot of things to talk about, a lot of fights that broke out.
Yeah, they say Virginia's for lovers, but you couldn't have told that by then.
No.
Martinsville race.
Somebody just bypassed that sign completely on the way out of town. But we don't have a guest tonight, so we're all just going to talk about what we saw, what we think we saw, what we didn't see, because apparently Tom did not see where Daniel Suarez threw his water bottle at William Byron's...
Yeah, I just missed
window
that
net.
Part of it.
And there's a bunch of stuff that I didn't even know happened either, so I guess we'll fill each other in on what we saw.
Well, it's easy to get lost in so many storylines.
That's true.
And across so many days. I mean, yeah, we're in Martinsville for so many days.
Where I want to start, though, is my disappointment in Martin Truex Jr. Not because he won, but because he stopped the streak from happening, and I really wanted to see the streak continue going. So, but I guess the best thing about streaks ending is that they could start all over again. So there are... tons and tons of people who still haven't won yet. So there's potential for us to have another seven in a row. It just won't be the same. What's the record? Does anybody know what the record is for?
Ten, I think, back in
2000.
Yeah. In a season?
Yeah. Well, to start a season.
In a whole season?
It was 19 in
2000.
I thought it was like 19 or 20. So
I thought you meant to start.
Think we're going to get there.
No.
But, I mean, there are still plenty of guys who haven't won. If you look at the second place finisher, Chase Elliott. Denny Hamlin, who dominated that race and still didn't visit victory lane. Kevin Harvick, Alex Bowman, Brad Keselowski. The list goes on and on and on. But
plumbing services.
Okay. That's great. Anyway.
That's what you get for having me push buttons. I didn't hit anything. It just wanted you to stop.
And we're back on the end.
And we're back. Welcome back.
Shortest commercial break in history.
I couldn't
tell
you what
happened. Shortest segment in history. I didn't even know we were going to commercial break. You were just like,
well, that's it, you know.
Anyway, so let's talk about what we saw at Martinsville. Peter, we'll start with you since you're on the other side of the room. What did you think of the Martinsville race?
I thought the dynamic of both races was interesting, being broken up across 2 days, but I thought Xfinity, I just love Xfinity being there. This is the second year they've been there, and why did Xfinity ever leave Martinsville? It's just such awesome racing and such a great story, seeing Josh Berry break through for his maiden win. You saw Gregson and Hemric, they obviously had the fight a couple weeks ago in Atlanta. They were going at it second and third, I believe, and they were racing for one of the stage wins, and then for the Cup race... obviously, Blaney dominated early, then you had Hamlin late, and Truex came out of nowhere, but a lot of different contenders. Just awesome racing at my favorite racetrack.
Yeah, I second all of that. We'll talk about Josh Berry in a little bit, too, because there's some interesting dynamics with his win, too. But
also, my streak's still alive.
Yes,
Bubba Wallace.
We were at the race.
16th.
Peter and I were both in Martinsville this weekend, and I looked at him and I said, "I don't know, Murdoch's streak might end today."
He led for a few laps,
and then he did.
Well,
he
was
put in the wall
really bad,
and then he
really
became Bubba
bad.
Wallace, and all was right.
Well, he was really, really bad at the start.
Oh no,
of that
he blew
race.
A tire, and then that's what.
But at the start of the race, he was so off.
I think Stenhouse passed him for 15th on the last lap, so your streak is alive by that much.
Yeah,
I think Murdoch actually blew the tire himself so that he wouldn't finish in the top 15.
Yeah. You guys don't know I was there.
His little BB gun in the corner.
I saw a little post today that said it was like a crying Michael Jordan, and it said Michael Jordan when he realizes he still hasn't beat Brad Daugherty in a race yet because JTG Daugherty drivers have still finished ahead of Bubba in every single race this season so far.
That's good stuff. Tom, what did you think of the race weekend?
Well, I mean, I guess we can get into detail later, but overall, yeah. I thought that it was actually a, oh my gosh, look at this. We got a whole screen segment countdown here.
Look at that.
Can't miss that. That's Chris is high tech tonight. I'm going to give a bell for that if I can get it to
if
work.
If you could hit the bell.
Yeah, I muted the bell. I thought it was, I mean, the racing I thought was really good. If not, I mean, the one thing I will say is I thought that the Cup drivers were way too aggressive. I just thought everybody was just completely over their head for a good three quarters of that race. Way too much contact, way too much through ride, way too much, you know, it was like, guys, this is a 500 lap race.
Cody Ware was drowning out there.
Well, that's, I mean, that could be a whole segment there. And I suspect it will later on, but yeah, it just was, I thought it was a very aggressively run race, but I thought both races were very interesting races with a lot of comers and goers, and I was super happy for Josh Berry, and we'll obviously get to that conversation shortly. But no, overall, I thought it was really good. I mean, I'll have some black flags for things that happened throughout the weekend as we get into the show more.
You have to stockpile your black flag for later on in the show.
Yeah.
I sentiment what Peter said about Xfinity going back to Martinsville. I wish that they never would have left. I actually wish that they would have just made it a triple header weekend and had the trucks there too. But I know the trucks are going to be back later in the season. But for me, I take away from the Cup race just the battle between Truex and Denny Hamlin and how those two being teammates and how they've had a history in the past of, you know, running over each other. But being able to go out there and run that second, you know, the last quarter of that race nearly side by side every single lap and not hardly touch each other and race each other respectfully as teammates is something that I didn't think I'd actually see going back to, you know, last year or the year before because of all the battles that they've had both on and off the racetrack and how much that, you know, disrespect they've shown to each other. But I guess knowing that now that they're, you know, they're getting older and, you know, they've been teammates for a little while now and knowing that, you know, Papa Gibbs is watching them and they probably shouldn't be doing that, especially running for the race win. It makes it more, I guess, more respectable. I mean, you know, you obviously want to see Denny Hamlin win at his home track or win in his home state, which he has another opportunity to do that this weekend. You know, I think it's proving that Martin Truex is starting to kind of come into his own now in that team. And, you know, he's going to become probably the more dominant driver of the four right now because it seems like he's going to be the Joe Gibbs guy to beat, especially here in the spring, the early part of the spring set of the season. Noah, what do you think?
Yeah, no, I mean, just as the weekend as a whole, like you guys mentioned, I mean, it was awesome to me because, like you said, Tom, the Cup race was extremely aggressive. There was a little bit, there was a little spot in between the middle of it where they kind of, you know, found their way around, and then I think we had a Rick Ware caution that stacked everybody back up. Go figure.
Most of the cautions.
Yeah, were Rick Ware cautions. Exactly.
So like, which one are you talking about?
Exactly. So, but nevertheless, I mean, you really saw such great racing all weekend. We talked about how you just talked about how they stayed side by side for a lot of the closing laps, and guys were having to use their bumper a little bit to move guys up and out of the racetrack, and the top lane was working in some ways, but the bottom was still preferred. I mean, it just to me looked amazing. Every part of it. There wasn't a clear cut person that stayed up, you know, our group that stayed up front all the race long. We saw so many, like you said, Tom, comers and goers, guys that fell off at the start and came back at the end or vice versa. So, I mean, it was really fun. I had a great time this weekend for sure.
You know, all weekend long, all we heard was everybody talking about how this is Kyle Larson's worst racetrack and he still finished fifth. So that, to me, is a scary statistic. If that's the worst track he can do and he still finishes fifth, you know, what the season is to come for that, for not only that team, but Hendrick Motorsports as a whole. Because William, I think that Alex Bowman had the best car of the Hendrick stable until he had the lug nut issue and had to drop in the back and then gotten caught up in that, you know, I-77 wreck that ultimately ended his day as well as a lot of other guys' days. But, you know, Chase Elliott came back to the field and ended up finishing second. William Byron got another top 10, and that he's finished in the top 10, I think, in every race since he won. So the streak continues for all those guys. But, man, Hendrick Motorsports is bringing it this year.
Yeah, Tom. Larson said post-race, he said, yeah, I was hoping that the Hendrick car would help my ability at Martinsville because there isn't much of one. And and then he said after, he said, don't let it fool you. I'm not any better. These cars are just really dang good.
Which is crazy because I saw a headline that said Joe Gibbs continues to dominate. And I was like, have you seen the Hendrick cars? Like, what are you talking about?
I think Hendrick and Penske are at the top of their game right now as a whole.
Gibbs only has one or two drivers that dominate every week. Hendrick is in the top 10 in every single race with all four or five.
You see most three of their cars.
Well, and I had to hand it to Byron's crew chief, too. I mean, you know, here this guy comes up from the trucks, slides into Cup, and acts like he's never, like he was
always
there.
He's been doing it for years.
You know, the idea that because the forecast was so bad for Saturday night that he actually set the car up in the shop for a day race gave them a huge advantage in the early, you know, part of the race on Sunday. And that was a really smart move. And you wonder how many other teams did that because, you know, again, the difference is always in the details. And I think William Byron's a championship contender this year because of that.
And you know, in every race, think about it, every race since he's gotten his win, he's either led laps or come close to leading laps.
Yeah, that's you know, and it's funny because you know Tom says that you know Rudy Fugel was smart enough to set the car up for the daytime, but if you watch the weather forecast, you should have done it anyways,
right?
Because you knew you wasn't going to race on Saturday night anyways. Which we'll talk about that after the break because that's a huge topic of discussion as to why NASCAR would decide to start the race on Saturday night, knowing they weren't going to be able to get it in. They weren't even going to get to 100 laps before the rain came again. So why would you even start the race knowing you weren't going to have a chance to finish it? We'll talk about that on the other side of the break because that's an interesting topic of discussion which got a lot of social media buzz, a lot of trending topics with rain and you know NASCAR's decision-making skills, which apparently were lacking over the weekend. And we'll talk about Josh Berry's win as well because that's a huge implication for the local scene as well. So we'll talk about that as well. We've got more racing talk on the other side of the break, and of course, Fantasy NASCAR, or as I like to call it, the Nick DeGroote Fantasy NASCAR League. We'll be back with more of the Inside Pass right around the turn. Stick with us. We will be right back.
Do you love the sound of high revving motors and the smell of burning rubber? Do you want to get your car sideways right at the ragged edge of control? If you've always wanted to try drifting or learn to improve your drifting skills, Summit Point Motorsports Park, the Mid-Atlantic's premier motorsports facility, has the expert instructors and the specialized track to teach you how to drift and the skills necessary to drift competitively. From skid pad to open sessions, Summit Point Motorsports Park has the safe and open environment that allows drifters of all skill levels, new to intermediate, to get sideways and smoking. With a focus on safety and the skill set necessary to drift competitively, Summit Point Motorsports Park's Drift Nirvana is just the thing for you. Call for your reservation today, 304-725-8444. Or for more information, go online, summitpoint-raceway.com, or you can email them at office@bsrinc.com. Drift Nirvana, getting you sideways the right way.
Victory Custom Trailers is the place to go for your next new or used trailer or coach. Being personally involved in the racing community allows Victory to fully understand what racers need in a trailer. They have over 200 coaches and trailers in stock for a variety of industries, and they can serve anyone in the continental U.S. If you're looking for something custom, they can assist in designing a trailer to fit your needs. Check out their entire inventory online at victorycustomtrailers.com.
I'm Andrew Saul, Commissioner of Social Security. Beware of telephone scammers pretending to be government employees. Real Social Security employees will never threaten you. Callers threatening you with arrest or other legal action and demanding money are not from us. If you receive a call like this, hang up, do not provide them with any form of payment or information. Report the call at oig.ssa.gov.
What an awesome game. What's up with your car?
I don't know. It won't start.
How are we getting home?
Chill. My parents signed me up for the roadside assistance from Lewis Meineke. It was free with my oil change. They'd come and get the car started or get us home and tow the car to the shop.
Good to know. With my driving, my parents never know what to expect.
When you join the Meineke Car Care Club with a $35 preferred service, you get 4 free months of roadside assistance, including tire change, battery jump, lockout service, towing, and more. Contact Lewis Meineke, located on Route 1, or call 827-2054.
When do you think of a plumber? Like most people, even if it's an emergency, you can be confident about who will arrive to help you. For quality and reliability, count on someone you can trust. Call on the plumbing services of Hague Quality Water of Maryland. Plumbing doesn't have to be an emergency. We handle all kinds of preventative maintenance, too. Hague Quality Water of Maryland is family-owned here in Annapolis since 1993. For a refreshing choice, call us at 888-84-WATER or visit us online.
This is Justin Locke, and you're listening to the best guys on the radio, The Inside Cast.
Welcome back to the Inside Pass. We're going to have to do a Facebook Live or TikTok or something during commercial breaks at some point to, you know, so people can see behind the scenes what we really do during commercial breaks.
It's boring. We just sit here and wait for the break to get over.
Yeah, that's not true. Well, most of the time it's true, but not all the time.
Yes, it is.
Anyways, welcome back to the Inside Pass. Randy Miller, Tom Baker, Peter Strada, Noah Lewis, and Chris Murdoch pushing our buttons and coming up with new high-tech ways for us to see the countdown. Which is stopped.
Is it moving? That's why I was pointing at
Wait
you.
Wait a second. Something's not right here. Anyway. Well, we tried.
No,
anyway. I want to talk about the NASCAR's decision to start the race on Saturday night, knowing that the monsoon was coming. I could have told them that in Charlotte because it started here before it got there. But this is the second race in a row over 3 weeks where we've been plagued by rain. I feel like Mother Nature doesn't like change very well because it rained out the Bristol Dirt Race for the first time ever, and then this was supposed to be the official first night race for Martinsville, and it got rained out too. I think Mother Nature's like, why are you changing the NASCAR schedule on me? I want old school, and I wanted to go back to normal. So, but NASCAR did make the decision to decide to start the NASCAR Cup race, knowing that the rain was about 45 minutes or an hour away, and once the rain got there, it wasn't going to stop, or at least stop in enough time to drive the track to where they wouldn't start before midnight. And so they decided to, let's just go for it anyways. Let's just send it, as they say. And so they went ahead and started the race, and what? How many laps did they get in?
42
or something like that.
Yeah.
Before the rains came, and they ultimately ended up postponing the race till Sunday afternoon anyway, after the Xfinity race. So I'm going to let Tom start because it's we have 9 minutes left, and he's going to take up 8 minutes and 55 seconds on this. So what is your take? Why do you think NASCAR decided to start the race before?
Well, first of all, I don't have my buzzer with me tonight, so there. That's the sound.
That was good enough.
It's close enough. That decision, to me, defied all logic. There was a 0% chance that we were going to get to halfway. So why in the world did you even go through the trouble of starting it? In fact, to me, I'm a guy who, you know, looks at the forecast, you just knew that nothing was going to happen. You could have basically just told everybody we're going to run on Sunday and been done with it, not even attempted to start. But you certainly shouldn't have thrown the green. That was the track conditions were definitely not great. The pit conditions were even worse. Mm-hmm. You had guys sliding around for 42 laps. You know, I don't know why NASCAR rushed. There were a number of things they did over the weekend that it just puzzled me. And this was one of them. I think NASCAR, something is happening in race operations where there's a lack of focus and quick decision-making judgment here. And this was definitely one of those situations where I just don't know what their logic was. It makes no sense. You say, well, we wanted to get as many laps in as we could. Why? It's going to be sunny tomorrow. Run the whole race in the same track condition. I mean, what if somebody crashes on lap 20 because the track's damp or whatever? Like, what are you doing?
By the way, it was raining when the green flag, when they took the green flag, it was actually already raining.
I just,
so, yeah.
I just think that was a bad call. I don't see any logic in it. Peter, I'll throw it to you. I don't see any logic in this at all and any reason why you start the race. I understand TV, but you also got to think about what's best for the race and the fans, and that was just a bad call.
Well, I think NASCAR is trying to decide with the TV window that's been broadcast all week, previewed leading up to Saturday night, and thinking about the fans in the stands. And then Mike Ford from NASCAR Communications said on Twitter yesterday, when the track is ready for racing and it's not raining, NASCAR will choose racing over waiting for it to rain every time.
Again, I say why. Rain's coming.
Yeah.
He also, you know.
Yeah, and he added to that, the radar said there would be a 0% chance, and if that was true, there wouldn't have been 43 laps run tonight. Radars aren't inevitable. Or infallible.
The radar did not say 0% chance of racing past two halfway.
Exactly. So that's my problem with it, because we do have a black and white rule,
right,
that says that if NASCAR does not feel that it can make it to halfway, then or to you know, halfway or the end of stage two. They will not.
It's not the end of stage two anymore. They changed that last year.
It's halfway.
It's whichever comes first. Halfway or end of stage two.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
In which case, halfway would have came after the end of stage two, wouldn't it?
Halfway was 250. End of stage two was 260. So halfway would have been slightly ahead.
They weren't going to. They got 42 laps.
Exactly.
Right. We're splitting.
So they weren't going to get there.
Apples and bananas at this point.
So, you know, if we're looking at that rule book, then we shouldn't have put cars on track and ran 42 laps. I agree.
I mean, I figure with all the team's efforts and, you know, getting the cars prepared, then, you know, scrambling around knowing that it's going to rain at some point.
And not
know,
only that,
you're wasting time.
Just how tired the track workers had to be from getting a quick turnaround of just a few hours of sleep at the hotel after trying to dry the Xfinity race out, and then coming and constantly working on the track to get the cup race ready, and then having to do that. I mean, there's just so many people involved that did not want to just sit around and watch the rain fall and face the inevitable. To me, that call should have been made well before it was.
Well, then also the thousands of dollars of jet fuel that you're wasting if you're just going to run the race in the rain anyways. Like,
well,
they started the race when
point.
It's raining anyway, yeah. So why would you even waste the time?
Well, they had to get it. See, there, I feel like this was like a dry run for the stupid rain tire idea. And
right.
The reality is that, again, you got 42 laps in. You might have gotten to about lap 100 or 110 if you put the stupid rain tires on, and you would have cost all the teams money for a set of rain tires. So what in the world did you do? Nothing. You just don't gain anything. I just think this was a case where, for whatever reason, NASCAR just, you know, it's like, we'll get whatever laps in we can. Well, okay, whatever. We obviously know that NASCAR's not going to ask us, and that's probably fair. But my opinion is, I think it was a bad call. I think you want to run the whole race at the same track condition if you can do it, and this was a case where you certainly could have made that happen.
All right, let's talk about Junior Motorsports for a minute. We'll get to Josh Berry in a second, but I found some interesting comments that Dale Jr. made over the weekend, where he discussed that he has talked to Kelly Earnhardt about the potential to turn the JRM into a cup, or I guess expand into a cup team, with the introduction of the next-gen car. He did not guarantee that it was going to happen, but said that based on all of the information coming in about this next-gen car, that this would be the opportunity for him to go cup racing with Junior Motorsports if he sees the opportunity. And the two things he wants to have happen: number one, he wants NASCAR to expand the number of charters available so that he doesn't have to spend an arm and a leg to buy one. And number two, he just wants to make sure that obviously they have a sponsor that would be willing to come on board to go cup racing should he decide to take Junior Motorsports cup racing. That is the potential, guys, for another team to enter the cup world when we get to the next gen car next year, Tom.
Yeah, I mean, and this has been rumored before that this is why the 88 got shelved. There was talk, and again, it's talk. We don't know if there's any truth at all to it.
Makes sense.
But yeah, I mean, it would, and let's put it this way, if there was no truth to it, it certainly would be a good situation if it needed to be, right? You know, that you could bring the 88 back for Dale. And put whoever in the car. And Dale did mention that he felt like Josh would be a driver to consider if you're going to start a cup team. I just sort of scratched my head at that, thinking to myself, okay, you got Allgaier over there, you got, you know,
Gregson,
you got Annette, you got all these, you know, like, why would you basically let Josh skip You know,
hop in for a few races.
You give him one Xfinity win, and all of a sudden he's a Cup Series driver.
I don't know. I mean, again, not disrespecting Josh's skill set. He'd probably be a good Cup driver, but I just thought that was interesting that it seems like Junior jumped right overboard on the Josh bandwagon there after one win at a track he's dominated at in the late models for years. But I think this is interesting. Now, again, talk has been made, Peter, about, well, you know, he and Rick have an agreement or whatever the case. Look, if Junior really wanted to go Cup racing, Mr. Hendrick would do whatever he could to help him.
Absolutely. We've seen ownership be murky between Penske and the Wood brothers, or between Joe Gibbs Racing now in 2311. So if Dale Jr. and Kelly Earnhardt Miller, that whole group over there, wants to go Cup racing, they will make it happen. And Randy said the perfect word, opportunity. The next-gen car, with it being a less expensive car, will open the door, lower the cost of entry to the Cup Series. We think colleagues doing racing next year. We've seen all the new teams this year. I think... Mm-hmm. At some point, Junior Motorsports will go Cup racing if the cards fall in the right area.
Yeah, look, I mean, they, you know, in their talks in that press conference, Dale said that he and Kelly have only had very minimal, just back and forth casual conversation. Yeah. There you go. And however, the fact that they are doing that, because for so many years, we know that Dale has said, that is not our goal. We're not going to do that. We are an Xfinity program. We will stay in it. So for them to even have, for him to open up enough to say, yeah, we've kind of talked about it a little bit, I think that's a big deal for them. So, you know, Chevy is an organization. They obviously have a lot of cars with RCR and Hendrick Motorsports. But if Hendrick Motorsports can have a very close aligned team, like 2311 to Joe Gibbs and things like that, I think that would be really good, because right now they've got such a young organization that they're going to need room.
Colleagues said the same thing, that they didn't want to go Cup racing either, and look at them. They're going to go Cup racing.
Let's just
next
expand
year.
The field. We'll have 50 cars.
It brings about an interesting dynamic, though, because you think, you know, this year you have Denny Hamlin, who's now co-owner of 2311 Racing, but still driving for Gibbs. You've got Junior, who owns JRM, which is essentially a Hendrick Xfinity team for the most part. And now the potential of taking JRM to the Cup Series, which means they would have a fifth Hendrick car, quote unquote, brings about an interesting dynamic with Penske, because Brad's in his last, you know, his one and only year of a contract, and he had a team before. So we'll talk more about that later. We'll take a break. We'll come back. We'll talk about Josh Berry when we come back, because it's locally inclined. We'll talk about that in just a minute. We'll be right back.
How to be a great dad in 15 seconds. Bike ride, go fish, walk in the park, phone call, milkshake, play catch, picnic, fly a kite, tell jokes, laugh, talk, read a story, tell a story, bumper car, swing set, bowling, pillow fight, cut loose, stay tight. Whew. Because the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Automotive technicians and auto service trainees, how would you like to work at the beach and perform for one of the best car care centers in the nation? Lewis Meineke is now looking for skilled automotive technicians to join their award-winning team. If you're a gearhead that knows his or her stuff, or a young up-and-comer that has the motivation and drive to succeed, then you need to make this call today. 302-827-2054. Lewis Meineke Car Care Center, located in beautiful Lewis, Delaware, offers a highly competitive compensation plan, great benefits, a flexible schedule, and did we mention that you're going to be working at the beach? Plus, there's a signing bonus for the right candidates. Technicians must be ASE certified and have a minimum of 6 years' experience. Beginners advance at your own pace in one of several entry-level positions. But whatever you do, don't wait. These jobs will go fast. Call Tim at 302-827-2054. That's 302-827-2054. Lewis Meineke Car Care Center. Rev up your career.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right. It's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
Victory Custom Trailers is the place to go for your next new or used trailer or coach. Being personally involved in the racing community allows Victory to fully understand what racers need in a trailer. They have over 200 coaches and trailers in stock for a variety of industries, and they can serve anyone in the continental U.S. If you're looking for something custom, they can assist in designing a trailer to fit your needs. Check out their entire inventory online at victorycustomtrailers.com.
He wanted to be known for doing his best.
You're right.
His best made him Major League Baseball's most valuable player.
Strike two.
He played in 6 World Series and was elected to the Hall of Fame. Oh. Although an honest man, he was best at stealing home. But the best quality of Jackie Robinson's life was his character. So here's to you, Mr. Robinson. Thanks for passing it on. From the Foundation for a Better Life at values.com.
I'm Matt DiBenedetto, the brutally honest NASCAR driver, and you're listening to the Inside Pass.
He had high praise from his team last night. He sent a tweet out saying how much he appreciated the team for being able to, you know, basically tear the car into nothing and then come back and finish 12th.
Yeah.
After the, you know, being involved in or having a blown tire and tearing up the fender. So that he needed that. He needed that 12th place finish for sure. Welcome back to the Inside Pass. Randy Miller, Tom Baker, Noah Lewis, Peter Strada, and Chris Murdoch pushing buttons for us. Before the break, I was talking about Penske. We were talking about Junior Motorsports and how if Junior decides to take JRM to a Cup Series team, then he would essentially have a fifth Hendrick car, because we all know that JRM and Hendrick are aligned. That would also kind of coincide with Denny Hamlin having 2311 racing and still driving for Gibbs. And then I brought about the possibility of this is Brad Keselowski's final year in his Penske contract. Who's to say that, I mean, he did own a team, he owned a Truck Series team before. Why, you know, why not start back up Brad Keselowski Racing and align it with Penske and have another fifth Penske team? I guess fourth Penske, well, fourth official team. But they only have 3 on Penske, plus Wood Brothers, which is a satellite team, so technically 4. Anyway, I digress. what would happen if that's a possibility? Because I heard a rumor somewhere along the way, and I'm not going to tell you who my sources were, but I heard a rumor that there was a possibility that with Cindric coming up to Cup next year to run the 21 car, that Penske would send Benedetto down to the Xfinity Series to run the Penske 22 car, and they would essentially flip places, and that would give Matt a year to kind of rejuvenate himself, which has been known to be quite a few cases where it would be a good idea to go down and then come back up again once you've gotten your feet wet again. But I don't know if that's true, just something I heard somewhere along the way. But Peter, what do you think?
You mentioning DiBenedetto and the Penske 22, I'm just thinking of how successful that car has been the past year or two. It won the title, obviously, last year on the strength of 5 wins, and has been the car to beat week in, week out this year. So if DiBenedetto hops into that car and the performance stays the same next year, then he'll have a shot at multiple wins.
It would keep him under the Penske stable, yeah. And that's kind of where I think the rumor started, was Penske doesn't want to let him go, but he didn't really have anything for him to do at the Cup level right now, so that would give him an option, Tom.
Well, it would be an interesting option for Matt, too, because if you think about it, if Cindric does come up and does go into the 21, then, you know, where is Matt going to go in the Cup Series that would be the equivalent of the 21 or better?
Mm-hmm.
And again, we don't know everything that's going to be open, but we would assume there probably wouldn't be a lot of opportunity there. So, you know, what is your best available option? Well, if the captain says, you know, here's the keys to the Xfinity 22, which, by the way, is the defending championship car, then you go ahead and just say, yeah, thank you, sir, and report to duty. That's I think that would be a great option for Matt to rejuvenate his career or to run there for as long as he could and he was, you know, wanted to. You know, to finish out his career, because, again, not everybody has to be in Cup. You make a good living in the Xfinity Series if you're running well.
And Matt's still fairly young. He's, what, 30? 31? Something like that? Is he even 30 yet?
I think he's just over 30.
Just 30 he's like 30 or 31. So, I mean, he's still relatively young, you know, still got a lot of time to go to the Xfinity Series, rehone his craft, and come back up to the Cup Series.
Sure.
So.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, and who knows? Like, you know... We don't know. We were just talking about the possibility of new teams with the new car and things like that. Who knows what opportunity will come knocking from a new team or something like that, too. So I don't think his options are completely limited, because I think we'll see a bit of a different Cup Series than we have right now in some ways. Whoa, Murdoch just went way low. But but
well, I have to make sure Randy can see over me to see the timer.
Like a squirrel looking for a nut.
Yeah. But that being said, yeah, I mean, we see AJ Allmendinger right now. He came back and he's running full time Xfinity, and man, he's tearing it up. And it's something that he wasn't able to do in the equipment he had in the Cup Series. And right now, he's very successful and having a lot of fun. So I don't think that it would be seen as a downgrade, maybe in Matt's eyes at first, because he wants to be in the Cup Series. He said that. However, like you said, Tom, you can make a decent living in the Xfinity Series and have a lot of fun too. And it's not as long. You don't even have to race as long.
Daniel Hemric comes to mind as well.
Well, and again, it's become more normal, more sort of, you know, acceptable the last few years to kind of go up and down as opportunity knocks and demands. So I don't think it's a big deal at all if he went back to Xfinity in a car like that. You'd have a shot at the championship right out of the gate.
Yeah.
All right, so let's talk about Josh Berry. He went out, won the Xfinity Series race for Junior Motorsports. That puts the 8 car in the Owners' Championship playoffs. He's not eligible, unfortunately, because he missed the Daytona Road Course race. Because they went with a ringer instead, they should have just left him in the car, and he would be eligible for the championship, but whatever. So
they'd have a lot to deal with, though, with Sam Mayer.
That's true.
And all that.
Well, and who would have thought in the second race of the year that Berry would have won at some point in time during the course of the season?
I raised the question before the season.
I mean, everyone knows that he's only running half the season anyways, because as soon as Sam Mayer hits 18, that's his birthday present. Here's your car.
Yeah.
In any event, he did win the race, the Xfinity race on Saturday. And so, you know, now I guess the question becomes what happens to Josh Berry at this point. You know, he's been running for Junior Motorsports for years in the late models, running the Cars Tour, running late model races all across the Southeast. And now getting the opportunity to run Xfinity, and you know, only having like a 12 race schedule or something at the beginning of the season, and now winning a race, that kind of makes you scratch your head a little bit, Tom, and think, maybe I should put him in the car full time.
Well, the problem is you've already thwarted your effort for the Drivers' Championship because you dug Miguel Peludo out of retirement to get into.
And he did nothing, by the way.
And he did nothing. You know, he totally did nothing for you on the road course.
That was just a cha-ching moment.
Yeah, I mean, Brandt. It was kind of like, you know, you should have just left Josh in it. And, you know, now he's won. So the Drivers' Championship, unless NASCAR is going to make an exception, and they should not do that.
I agree.
Because you open up a giant can of worms if you do that. You know, because he'd have to go to another car to begin with, because you're not going to give, you know, Mayer's money back. So Sam is going to get into the car. So the car is basically positioned. It's in the owner's points. You know, the owner's playoffs, if anybody cares about that other than the owners. it's in the owner's, you know, deal. So there's that. But at this point, the best that Josh can hope for is that he does well the rest of his time, and maybe somebody gives him an opportunity beyond this in another car somewhere, you know, but he's not going to be in the playoffs one way or another. Yeah. And that's too bad, because, you know, again, I think you go down the stretch, you look at the playoff tracks, with the exception of the Roval and, you know, that type of deal where, you know, it's out of his experience element. You know, you figure by that time in the year, he's kind of shot to win some. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's too bad that didn't work out for him. But hopefully he may get some more races in somebody else's car down the road here this year.
Yeah, I mean, and he's run decently. He hasn't shown any, you know, crazy speed on different tracks other than this weekend.
L for learning.
Yeah, exactly. And so it's his first, you know, these are his first starts in the series. And so you wouldn't expect him to come out and Ty Gibbs the field or
no,
anything.
He's actually had a couple of other starts.
Well, yeah, but yeah. in recent history. So, again, Dale Jr. in his conference, you know, on the many things he spoke upon, he said our goal is to get Josh Berry full time somewhere at some point, and they want to get the partnership and the sponsorship together to do that. I don't know if that means JRM this season opening a fifth car and a fifth team, somehow working through that if they can find what they can find, or if that means next season. But he did say that their goal is to have him at the home stable with a full-time opportunity.
My vote at the home stable, keep him in the late models. there's a lot of young talent out there that deserve a ride more than Josh Berry does.
But it seems it just seems that Dale Jr. has a very steep emotional and friendship.
Well, they're best friends. Yeah. They've been best friends since 2002.
Exactly.
But
so
I think
that's
friendship should.
A lot of,
here's my two cents on that. I disagree with Chris, and here's why. I understand why Chris says what he says, but I think we need to. If we all believe that we need to get away from this, you know, it should just be about young rich kids. Then Josh Berry is the poster child for, look, the guy went out. He just won you a race. Mm-hmm. He's proven he's a smart driver. So, you know, if you can get him full time, let's get away from this idea that if you're over 23, you're disqualified from full time opportunity. Josh has nothing more to accomplish in the late models. He can still work for Junior during the week overseeing that program. He doesn't need to be in the late model anymore. He's beat up on the kids enough.
Josh, put him
in the Xfinity series and give him a chance to go to Cup if he can earn it.
Josh truly has won everything there is to win in a late model. He's won the Valley Star 300 up in Martinsville.
He led all
300
laps for crying out loud.
He did, yeah. He won
the whole race.
He won the National Weekly Series Championship last year. So, yes, I think he wants to do bigger and better things in some NASCAR capacity, whether that's truck, Xfinity, or even Cup someday. I really look at Josh Berry this year as A.J. Allmendinger last year. When Allmendinger won in Atlanta, he knew he wasn't running for the championship. There was no controversy over him making or not making the playoffs. So I think if Berry continues to show out in his opportunities this year, there could be a full-time seat for him at JRM or elsewhere next year.
And we've seen them run fast with five teams. They can do it. They just have to put the money together to do it.
Well, that's the thing. It's all resources at this point. But, you know, again, if Gregson's going to go somewhere else next year, throw him in the 9 car. Let's go. The guy's earned his shot. I think we got to bust this bubble about the older guys. You know, Junior proved if you give them a chance, they can make good. And so I think we need to bust the age bubble.
When is Pilot finally going to stop backing? I mean, you know, sorry, Michael McDowell.
I was about to say, you can only bust that bubble once Barry brings funding for it.
Well, but again, if you have fun, my point is if you're 30 and you've proven yourself and you have some funding, you know, then do it. And I think we got to get these sponsors out of this. You know, everybody needs to get out of the idea that we got to throw these 18-year-olds right into Xfinity all the time.
That's true. We are coming up on a break, but I wanted to send well wishes to Taylor Gray. Taylor was involved in a pretty bad automobile accident over the weekend, and he's recovering. He's going to be out for a little while. He's got some broken legs and some broken bones.
Well, he broke his L4 vertebrae, and he had an ankle. Injury.
So he'll be out for a little while, but we wish him his speedy recovery, and hopefully he was supposed to be in the truck, I think, this coming weekend.
In Richmond, yes.
Not going to happen.
Probably won't get in this season.
So we will keep you posted on what's going on with that. We are going to take a break. We'll do Fantasy NASCAR when we come back, and we've got some more stories to talk about. We'll do it when we come back. The Inside Pass comes back next.
How to be a great dad in 15 seconds. Bike ride, go fish, walk in the park, phone call, milkshake, play catch, picnic, fly a kite, tell jokes, laugh, talk, read a story, tell a story, bumper car, swing set, bowling, pillow fight, cut loose, stay tight. Whew. Because the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Automotive technicians and auto service trainees, how would you like to work at the beach and perform for one of the best car care centers in the nation? Lewis Meineke is now looking for skilled automotive technicians to join their award-winning team. If you're a gearhead that knows his or her stuff, or a young up-and-comer that has the motivation and drive to succeed, then you need to make this call today. 302-827-2054. Lewis Meineke Car Care Center, located in beautiful Lewis, Delaware, offers a highly competitive compensation plan, great benefits, a flexible schedule, and did we mention that you're going to be working at the beach? Plus, there's a signing bonus for the right candidates. Technicians must be ASE certified and have a minimum of 6 years experience. Beginners advance at your own pace in one of several entry-level positions. But whatever you do, don't wait. These jobs will go fast. Call Tim at 302-827-2054. That's 302-827-2054. Lewis Meineke Car Care Center. Rev up your career.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right, it's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette, it's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes, on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
He wanted to be known for doing his best.
Sure, you're right.
His best made him Major League Baseball's most valuable player.
Strike two.
He played in 6 World Series and was elected to the Hall of Fame. Oh. Although an honest man, he was best at stealing home.
Save.
But the best quality of Jackie Robinson's life was his character. So here's to you, Mr. Robinson. Thanks for passing it on. From the Foundation for a Better Life at values.com.
When Marlon Shirley was 5 years old, he was in an accident and lost his foot, but he didn't lose his heart.
When you tackle a challenge that you just cannot even fathom tackling, when you accomplish that, the amount of integrity and the will and the heart that you'll get from that experience is what will set you up for your life.
In less time than it took Marlon Shirley to say that, he can now run 100 meters because today he's the world's fastest amputee. Overcome. Pass it on from the Foundation for a Better Life at values.com.
Hi, I'm Mike Lynette. You're not making it work on the outside. Make sure you listen to the inside pass.
Welcome back to the inside pass. I'm Sorry, Tom Baker, Noah Lewis, Peter Strada, Chris Murdoch. Pushing buttons and doing our weekly thing. If you miss any part of our show, you can catch it on demand. Just search for the Inside Pass on any of your favorite podcasting websites or Race Chaser Radio, and you will find them all there. Next week on the show, we've got brand new daddy, John Hunter Nemechek. Hopefully he wins this weekend, and then that would make it all easier for all of us. But he'll be on, and then, of course, you know, Nick DeGroote has to come on because – you know, he's a glutton for punishment. I don't know which. He's officially sponsoring our fantasy NASCAR standings now because he's been in front so long that I
caught him a little bit this week.
Yeah, everybody's kind of catching up to Nick, but Nick's still
in front.
I needed
him to have a bad week.
So let's do our fantasy picks real quick, and then we've got some other stuff to talk about. So we'll go through this real quick. I'll do mine real quick. I'm taking John Hunter Nemechek because I really want to see him win so that when he comes on the show, it counts as a win. And I'm taking Hamlin in the Cup Series because he didn't win last week. He's bound to win at some point. Tom, who are you picking? Trucks and Cup this week. No Xfinity, they're off this
I'm
week.
Glad that you clarified that. Not that I needed to know. This is Richmond. So for the Truck Series, I am going to go with the two of Sheldon Creed, and I'm going to, for the Cup race, I'm going to go for Clint Boyd. No, wait a minute. He retired. I'm going to go with my pick, Denny Hamlin.
Hamlin. All right. Yeah. Chris.
We're Trucks and Cup?
Yep, Trucks and Cup.
Trucks is going to be Sheldon Creed.
Okay.
Cup will be Kyle Busch.
All right, Noah.
I have the Trucks as Kyle Busch, and I will pick my Cup pick as Brad Keselowski.
I was too busy fixing the show. I couldn't listen to who was racing. If Kyle Busch,
yeah, I didn't even know he was racing.
Do you want to change to Kyle Busch?
No.
Okay.
I don't. I don't think he cares. Peter.
Noah took both of my picks, and
I didn't.
You did. I was thinking Busch and Keselowski because I need points.
He told me who he was thinking on the way. He was not thinking Busch.
I'll go with my backup for Cup at least because I do think Kyle easily wins the truck race. Maybe John Hunter Nemechek wins the stages miraculously again, but Kyle, I think, will be out front at the checkered flag. And for Cup, I'll go Denny Hamlin, join that train.
Wait, who did you pick for trucks?
Kyle
Busch.
Oh, that's your.
Well,
On the way here,
I told him Kyle was in the race. He goes, no, I'm still going to pick my other pick.
The funny thing is that last week you were going to pick Truex.
He lied.
And you
he
didn't
lied.
Because you said you didn't want to pick Truex twice.
I know. Don't remind me. But I still got a fourth place finish with William Byron.
That is true. You did. All right. So we had some other stuff to talk about, but there's other like fights and things that happened at Martinsville that I feel like we should get to because there was a lot of things happening. Rick Ware Racing and Joe Graff Jr. got into a fight. And so some of the officials, I think, fought each other just because they were looking at each other wrong. So I don't even know all that happened. I know the Suarez and the Suarez. Who did he throw the Byron? Byron. Yeah. I know about that incident, but I didn't hear about all. I heard about the Joe Graff Jr. one because I saw it on social media. But all the other fights, I don't know what happened with Rick Ware. Like, we'll start there because I don't even know what happened with that one.
That was what happened was Cody Ware wrecked James Davis and his teammate.
Well, then they had a brawl Sunday, running from like 65th position.
And then it continued after the race, apparently. And, you know, Cody was mouthy on the radio, and I guess Dad told him to quit and, you know, all that. So,
and they used some fists.
You know, you've got, and it's like, look, to me, I'm not, and I don't. I really want to be mean here, but to me, it's like you can barely stay on the lead lap, you guys. Like, why are you you caused like three or four yellows between you. And it's like James Davison is a well-experienced, top-notch racer. Why he is messing around in the Cup Series with Rick Ware when he knows full well he's not going to get past 25th, I don't know. I mean, the equipment's just not there, so Rick must be paying him really well because he's actually said he's going to skip the Indy 500 to concentrate on NASCAR, and I'm like, why? You could win Indy. So I mean, we know that Rick's business model is for profit. The performance doesn't matter. They're not even trying to be competitive. He's giving sponsors really nice experiences and putting a lot of money in his pocket, which is, I guess that's wise if you're him and you can keep it up. But I just feel like that's the biggest black flag for me is that one. And then Greg Galding and James Graff ending up in a fight was, you know, another example of, you know, Gray moved him and ended up causing a wreck on the track. And then, you know, I guess went on somewhere and bragged or something. I don't know. But we had a lot of that. We had a lot of dumps go on at Martinsville. Kyle Weatherman dumped Colby Howard, the Xfinity race, and you had, you know, Gray moving Graff and all kinds
Annette
of
Annette trying
stuff.
To dump some. I can't remember who it was at this point.
I mean, there were more brawls and arguments.
Ross Chastain sent it in turn
Ross
three.
Chastain
yeah, what
just
in the world was he doing?
In there.
It's like he thought he was running a drag strip, apparently, and didn't want to turn
Brad
left.
Then under caution, Brad was giving him a little bump and runs and little things like that. Yeah. And I knew if Brad got back to him, it was going to be crazy. And unfortunately, he was caught up in the big
one. And meanwhile, while all this is going on, the usual instigator of all this, Noah Gregson's holding a $100,000 check in his hand because he won the Dash for Cash.
Well, and I'm going to give him a bell because, again, Noah drove a great
Unproblematic
race.
Unproblematic weekend for Noah. That deserves a bell, yes.
Noah beat everybody but his teammate. So, you know, I mean, that's a really good run for him. And I think, you know, especially at Martinsville where it's so easy to get over aggressive and make somebody mad and end up with a, you know, a big deal. Noah didn't do that. Noah drove a nice race the other day. So I think you got to give him a lot of credit. You know, so that was, yeah, he won, ended up winning the first round of, the Dash for Cash. And again, ran a nice race. I think that there's a lot of drivers that are going into Richmond to make some phone calls this
week
and get
place
things
to go?
Straightened out. Yeah. Well, it's better than Martinsville.
Yeah, yeah.
Peter said it best at the beginning of the show that everybody's Christmas card list got a little bit shorter.
Yeah, or a lot. You know, and I mean, it's just, I don't know. I really feel like that there are certain teams in certain situations where, you know, at some point NASCAR is going to have to figure some things out here, and that's all I'm going to say because it's just getting ridiculous, but
charters need to go to teams that are actually going to try to compete.
Well, and that's why when you mentioned earlier about Dale Jr. suggesting they expand the charters, I think we should in Cup. You know, if you're going to have 40 starting spots, give 40 charters. And I mean, I understand, you know, what you were doing with the 36 at the time, but you know, you've got some charters out there with teams that aren't even trying, and I think that's sad. They're just taking money out of the sport. They're really not doing anything good for it, in my opinion.
Well, when you get to an opportunity like next year, when the next gen car comes out, you've got all these new teams that are wanting to get started, from colleague to potential to junior motorsports, and you know they're going to be faster than the guys who aren't trying.
Right.
So they don't have a charter. They're going to have to go home, while the guys that aren't trying are going to get to run the race.
Right.
And that's where the unfairness comes into play out, because you know that the junior motorsports guys and the colleague guys are going to have a lot of good sponsorship and potentially new sponsorship coming into the sport, and they're going to want their product to be featured in a race. And it's going to be tough for those guys to explain to their sponsors, well, yeah, we were fast, but because of the charter rule, we can't race. Whereas, you know, Rick Ware Racing, who's competing for 67th place, 97,000 laps down, is going to get to run every week. And right. It's the same thing with, like, Jordan Anderson this year. You know, he has heart set on becoming an Xfinity Series team and running an Xfinity Series car, and now he's got to wait till May or sometime
because
in May
we can
or June.
Qualify and they start the race on owner's points, which he doesn't have.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So there are things that obviously can be changed.
I think we need to expand field size again as well, 43 or something.
If we're going to get to a point where we're getting new teams and new sponsors in the sport, I absolutely agree. We do need to have more cars on the racetrack to accommodate everybody that shows up to the racetrack. So, guys, it's been fun. We appreciate everybody tuning in this week. Don't forget, next week, John Hunter Nemechek will be with us. We got a bunch of good shows coming up in the month of May that we're excited to hopefully reveal to you guys in the next couple of weeks. So for all the cast and characters here on our show, we will see you next week. Have a great weekend. Enjoy Richmond, and we'll see you next week on the Inside Pass. Goodbye, everyone.